Hello, I am Chauncey DeVega. You may recognize my voice from Ring of Fire Radio with Mike Papantonio, the BBC, Sirius XM, or the Tom Hartman Radio Show. And you may have read some of my essays at places like Salon and Alternate. I would like to thank all of you for listening to, downloading, tweeting, and sharing the eponymously named podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show.
And they ran a story by somebody named Chauncey DeVega.
Quote, I find black garbage pail kids, black conservatives, fascinating.
That's just unbelievable, you know.
He goes by the name of Chauncey DeVega.
You know, I've been called Uncle Tom, Oreo, sellout, shameless. But this is a new one.
Well, let's talk now to Chauncey DeVega.
As my man Chauncey DeVega of the blog We Are Respectable Negroes says,
I have author and blogger Chauncey DeVega here with us.
Hello there, and welcome to the first podcast of 2016 for the eponymously named podcast. You see that? Two podcasts known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. You may notice my voice is a little hoarse, not its normal, beautiful baritone that moves women's loins, that changes the world, the timbre of my voice, because I have a barber who has the cooties, who decides that he's going to cut hair while sick and breathing on folk. I almost got out the chair, people. They're lucky, I tell you. They're lucky I'm not in charge. Over there in Iran, they got the mullahs, those morality police. Well, I would have the cootie police. So I got ginger tea. And I've got a new beverage to share with you. As always, I want to thank all of you kind folks who listen to, download, tweet, and share the podcast. Had a very busy week, very, very, very busy week. I'll talk to you guys about that. Of course, I have those two great announcements coming up. I'm still teasing them. You got to tease sometimes. No, I'm actually just waiting for some final things to be announced and approved, but everything is a green light. Did a lot of TV and radio this week, at least by my standards. I don't know how there are folks who can do 2-3 shows a day. I did Tom Hartman, the radio show and the TV show. And I was also on Ring of Fire. You can find both of those, or all three of those appearances, actually online. So this great show, Dave Silverman, president of the American Atheist Association, author of the great new book, Fighting God. We talk about religion, faith, identity. I talked to the brother about the theodicy question, as I also try to figure out my own sort of path. Apparently, David went and confirmed my atheism. I say I'm an atheist who believes in God. He said, that's mealy-mouthed and weak. So we talk about his thesis, his hypothesis, his life journey in terms of his experience with religious faith, ISIS, the war in the Middle East. He has some creative solutions for testing the end times hypothesis held by these ISIS lunatics, as well as Christian dominionist fundamentalist lunatics here in this country, too. Man, so much going on. I demurred on doing this before, but I do want to do it now, because she means the world to me. She's a dear friend. You may have been following the story about Professor Larisha Hawkins at Wheaton University. She's a very, very close friend of mine, and all her travails and troubles. As I said earlier, I actually had recorded something about this 2-3 weeks ago when it first broke. If you don't know, she has been standing in unity with her Muslim brothers and sisters against Islamophobia by wearing a hijab. She has been harassed by her employer and potentially may actually be fired. A woman has tenure and may be fired from her employer, and she is one of the strongest, smartest, toughest, most principled people that I know. And I just want to send her out some love. You can Google her name. You've seen her probably on all sorts of news stations talking about this. If you're in the Chicago area, they just had a rally on Wednesday. A whole bunch of folk were there standing in unity with her. So I want all of us, if you can, send her some positive energy. You may not be religious. Certainly I'm not. You may be an atheist. You may be a very religious and spiritual person, but this is about principle and about academic freedom and intellectual and professional integrity. And she is a cut above the rest. So she needs our love, our support. So send her out some positive energy. And I was back and forth. I'm like, man, Chauncey, you don't want to put your friend's business out there. But when in times of trouble, you got to stand with your people. You got to stand with your people whenever you can. You'll notice some things, too, swerving back. I mean, so much going on. We got the Bundy brigands, insurrectionist, militia, cowboy cosplayers out in Oregon. I've written a lot about that. My most popular piece, I'm sure you guys have been following this online, that I've ever done. I'm basically, you know, using Facebook more. I did a series of pieces, too. One that just featured that cartoon about poor, poor, poor Tamir Rice. On one side, a little black boy, 12 years old, killed, labeled as a thug, as a threat you need to escalate to immediate and horrific violence against him because he's a black child with a gun versus an NRA member with a hat and assault rifle. And one is he's considered a patriot. To me, another little black boys and girls are considered thugs. And I wrote a follow-up to that. It went viral, 350,000+, actually 400,000 between that piece and my follow-up online. And it just sort of took on a life of its own. So you may have encountered that in your inbox. You know how the young kids say, you gonna inbox me? I wanna inbox you. I've never got, the only inboxes I get on Facebook is white supremacists threatening to kill me and people circulating right-wing feces. Well, I actually do get some kind emails too, so I wanna take that back. But hold on, I got to have a preemptive swig. I'm so lucky that my voice held up during my interviews on Tom Hartman and Ring of Fire, because I would have been in trouble. Last time, I looked like a turtle, a pumpkin man. As they said, looked like I was high on bath salts on that other radio show. But let me preemptively, because I got to preempt, I got to get a swig of this new stuff. Hold on. I'm reaching over for it. It's in my metal army cup. Hold on.
Roll in the chair.
Alrighty. I'm going to leave that in. We call that ambiance. So you're hearing it. I usually go later for our swig. And I was joking. And it's funny. I want to give some love out to the folks who've emailed me about my soda addiction. They are very concerned, but apparently there are lots of folks who have a similar condition. One of them, a Grateful Dead fan who was here in Chicago, gave me some soda tips. Ooh, there's so many of us out here who need to join Soda Anonymous. So instead of soda, I'm doing something different because you got to come down off the addiction. Because, you know, for New Year's, I had ribs. I lay around. I was a bum, slept, drank too much, but I didn't get drunk. I could have gone out. I stayed in because I'm old. I spent all those years DJing and carrying on New Year's. At this point in my life, I'm just like, I'm going to keep my black behind in the house on New Year's. So this is a new concoction, you see. I feel like a sophisticated Paul Newman. I think Paul Newman invented this drink, or he popularized it. Lemonade and iced tea from a company called Oberweiss. Got that here locally in Chicago. Now, it's supposed to be the best. Now, hopefully it will enliven my vocal cords. Hold on now, because we got that great conversation with David Silverman coming up. But you know the melanin has got to get the high fructose corn syrup. So let me take a sip of this here. Whew, that's sweet. That's like I'm sucking out a bumblebee's butt. Whew, let me have some more of that sweetness. I'm feeling the melanin. The melanin is getting circulated by the vitamin C. Hold on. Now, Coca-Cola is a carbonated beverage. It has more life. But this is like heavy, heavy sugar. Oh, yeah. It's clear in the throat. Hold on. Clear in the nostrils. I give this a B+, A-. It is not as exciting as soda, although I think I'm going to experiment with this Oberweiss lemonade iced tea by adding some ginger ale next time. Woo-hoo, I'm a soda alchemist. Let me get one more quick swig before we get to this great podcast episode. And we got some other stuff going on too, but I just need another swig. Yeah, that's good. Dave Silverman is the guest on this week's episode of the eponymously named podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. As I said, you know, I did Ring of Fire, about 13-minute segment that is airing Thursday night and Friday night. Me and Ferran Cousins talked about the obvious contradiction and hypocrisy here. And I also talked to Tom Hartman about this. I don't know who in their right mind. They must be on bath salts themselves, or maybe they're professional contrarians, or maybe they're just in denial. And I wrote about this. You can look at the events in Oregon with those white homosexual cosplayer Bundy public welfare teat suckers running around with their freedom muskets, confused about the Constitution, don't understand the history of the document, think they're a militia when they're really an insurrectionist terrorist group, can sit there and say that race has nothing to do with it. Or can sit there and say that, well, if they were black or brown or Muslim, they would not necessarily be treated any differently. Well, I have a bet for anyone who believes that. And there's some prominent people who have mouth bloviated, whose work I like. And I say mouth bloviate because you can bloviate in other ways. By the way, people who want to be grammarians. Here's an experiment. Get some black people together. Give them guns. Have them go take over federal property. I don't care if it's in the middle of nowhere, Saskatoon, of the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. Have them make a jihadist martyrdom videos where they're saying they're going to kill the cops and die fighting the government. Make the people who live there so scared they don't go to school. The kids stay in the house. The businesses close. And we'll see how you're treated. And I know, and I pointed out to this in a follow-up, I said, yeah, it's an empirical question. I'm sure there's some really smart folks who write about politics and violence, social movement behavior, state power, who could probably give us a really well-grounded empirical answer to say, okay, in these contexts, in these examples, the state responds this way. It's a very easy model to set up, actually. Race is a variable in this way. You got the dependent variable, which would be violence or no violence, perhaps, or range of response. And then you have your answer. But I'm telling you, common sense, intuition. See, I went to a public school. I don't overthink the obvious. Although there are great answers that can be had by overthinking the obvious. Black or brown, you'd be a militant. You'd be a thug. God forbid if you're a Muslim, you'd be a terrorist. And it would be on Fox News 24/7. It would be all over the internet 24/7. Just look at the framing of the narrative. They did everything they could to avoid mentioning these people were armed. I think I only found one. It was a foreign newspaper that mentioned these Bundy brigands in Oregon are white. See, to be white, man, that's the complexion for the protection. You're neutral, you're a quote-unquote American, and your race is not to be mentioned. Even though whiteness and white privilege are all over what's going on. I have a piece of ChaunceyDeVega.com about that. These white cowboy cosplayers are manifest destiny knuckleheads trying to steal First Nations people's land, the land of the public, so they can go because they dream it's theirs. That's what manifest destiny is. Hair invoke ideology. White supremacist dreaming is about land stealing, entitlement. Remember, affirmative action in this country has always been white. And one of the greatest perks of affirmative action in this country is the ability to steal other people's land and labor. But the deep game, as I said, go to ChaunceyDeVega.com, all right? Link to it is about the Koch brothers, it's about privatization, and it's about white supremacy. And so few people are willing to talk about the deep connections between these militia groups and white nationalist, white identity, white supremacist organizations. It's not a coincidence there ain't too many black folks. There's always one token Negro in the lot, in the watermelon patch, as my granddaddy would say. Hold on, I got to have another swig of this. This is good. Ooh, it's a different sort of high. Like I said, it's like sucking on a bee's butt. There's apparently a delicacy you can get on the plains of Africa, if you ever happen to be there, where you got bees and they dig into these trees and they'll attack you. And what you do is you get a piece of wood and you smoke them out. And then you take the honeycombs and you eat it. And apparently there are some birds that hover about like hummingbirds and they'll get that honey too. But see, they get in there and their feathers protect them, but not man. We don't have feathers. And it's supposed to be some of the best honey in the world. So I'm telling you, this Oberweis stuff is pretty damn close. So you'll notice, as I was joking last week, because I'm vain, I care about my appearance. If the world is going to see you, I don't care if it's 10 or a million, and you're a sexual dynamo like me, a god, an Adonis, you want to look good. So I've been fidgeting and concerned about my appearance on these internet TV thingies. So I'm going to give you a little insight. I hinted at it before. We talked about it very, very briefly. A lot of times you do these interviews, you do them from home. You got a little home studio set up. You get the lighting. You get the video equipment. You get a backdrop. You get a green screen. All that stuff, by the way, I'm investing in because of the kind folks who donated to the fundraiser in December. I'm telling you, we got something so cool coming up, people. And we're going to make sure it's tight and it's good and it's not raggedy. So you're not there. I've done a few studio interviews, but for the most part, it's easier and cheaper for them to just call you up. So you get everything all prepared. You do a little research like I've done. You try to figure out three-point lighting. All this stuff, and this stuff can get so elaborate. Unless you have like a nice big house and a basement where you can just leave the stuff up, you are rearranging, you're moving things. And you're not an expert. You're not an expert. So as I said, we're friends here at the Virtual Bar and Salon, so I tell the truth about things. So you're getting better at things. You're figuring out your appearance and you discover things like you look like a pumpkin. And then I started thinking, you know, like we've talked about this before. There's a whole history with how to light people of color going in Hollywood, right? White folks were lit one way and the color timing on film was another way. And I can see that now just as a layperson who's done, you know, quite a few dozen now of these interviews. You go back to the original ones. The more recent ones are getting better and better because I've been asking people how to do this and set the equipment up because I'm hard-headed and willful. And sometimes you're stuck in my ways. I'm like, no, this is not right. But it's really, really hard. It's like you get your skin tone, you're wearing something white. And I made a great discovery that you got the fancy video camera that I spent a good sum of money on, and you can use it through the computer. Did you know, people, and this is for all of you intrepid podcasters, people who have a webcam, who want to do a YouTube video, if you ever want to do an interview for your job, increasingly those are done at home. You want to look good, so get some lighting on you. Get them nice, warm, neon bulbs. Make you look good, but if the settings aren't right, they'll make you look like a pumpkin. And actually, in this last interview, I look more like a squash, a gourd. But maybe I am gourd-like in color. Maybe that's just the truth, and you see yourself on camera. It's never the same as seeing yourself in a mirror, by the way our brain processes the information. Same thing as hearing yourself recorded or hearing yourself on the telephone as opposed to how your voice sounds in your head. So you got all these settings. So you got gain, brightness, contrast, hue, white balance, and a few other ones. And I discovered that they're not all the same. Now, let me give you another little hint. Yes, I'm stupid. So you adjust one thing, like that gain is all the signal. And that adds artifacts, make the image look weird, or it can boost the signal. Now, when we first started this journey, intrepid people, this is why some folks have actually emailed me this. They're like, Chauncey, you look a little different in the last two interviews. What the hell? Are you the same person? I'm like, yeah. Is that I had the gain on the camera turned to zero because it's supposed to make the signal on the internet better. Well, if you do that, the signal is lower, but it looks like garbage. And then I also had the exposure up too high. And here's another thing I learned. I joked about it on the website. If the camera is too close to your face, even if you're beautiful, I have an angular face. Oh, it's so sexy. Your face will look like a pumpkin. It'll be round. So you're going to notice some even better improvements as we get our new equipment set up. And I will look like the man that I am. It's vanity. And it's also trying to put out the best product I can. But I want to thank the folks who emailed me about those appearances. And I think they went well. We did some good teaching, some good sharing. I got some kind emails from the Tom Hartman appearance. And, you know, folks ask me. I don't really prepare. I know what we're going to say. And I have a lot of admiration for folks who can do this every day and come up with something different. It is not easy. And then the other thing I've noticed about myself is that the slower I try to speak, and you saw I did this three times on the Hartman interview on the RT network, that the more speech affects I have. So I got to find a balance. I did not like saying, and I tried to be more expressive, but if you discover you look up in the sky and you have that moment where you collect your thoughts, somebody can pause that, make you look like a monster, eyes up in the head, tongue sticking out. And I know my lips were chapped. I was licking them. I was trying to moisten them, but the camera's so damn close. It's just hard to be beautiful when the camera's that close. But enough of my ramblings. I'm going to have one more swig of this wonderful lemonade iced tea. We've got a great conversation with Dave Silverman coming up. And I mean, for 2016, we have got some amazing guests. I sent an email out to somebody today. I said, what the hell? He's doing interviews. Maybe I can get 30 minutes of his time. Great interviews coming up. As I said, we're approaching episode 100 in terms of what has been recorded. And I got some interviews from 6 months or a year ago. And I actually had to call people back up and say, let's update this. Let's do an end around. Because I try to get things as early as I can. But I think you're going to like this one. I think it's honest. Dave Silverman is a dynamic personality. His new book, Fighting God, is just out now, New York Times, I believe, bestseller. It's on the list. And I drop the mask a little bit and talk about my own religious journey or lack thereof or movement away from, questions I have about faith, theodicy. Some things, as I said, you know, we just start vibing. So, you know, it's the early part of the conversation is, hey, setting things up. Let's do the business. Let's talk about the book. How do you feel? Then we get into sort of thinking about politics. And then, of course, it's a tired statement, but the personal is political. It really is. So I talk about some of my experiences with the folks who have converted to religion. So I know several who have. The more religiously minded, not like my wonderful friend Larisha Hawkins. She's religiously minded, but she's a wonderful person. You know, I think religion can be a force for good and for evil. That is for sure. But I think more often than not, especially with converts, it changes them. And I think it probably changes them in many instances for the worse, taking everything bad about them and amplifying it because it gives them some sort of theological hook about their imaginary sky father. However they define God, a mythological being. But then again, you got folks who go to prison, who get some religion, and they stop killing, they stop raping, they stop using drugs. But then again, they're probably really judgmental about the people who still are. So this is a complicated matter, and I think we do some honesty here. We do some sharing. And whenever I talk about these personal matters, my goal is always to be myself, is to share, give as much as I get. And sometimes folks ask me about oversharing or the limits of what you talk about, and I say, I try to tell the truth. as best I have experienced it, and my truth may not be somebody else's truth, especially about intimate matters of religion, faith, life experience. But I feel very comfortable saying that, like our guest on this great episode of the podcast, I think religion is a form of human livestock management that has been more of a negative than a positive in terms of human civilization. But you may feel free to agree or disagree, so please email me. You know I love reading my emails. Hate mail, compliments, sexy emails. Although I haven't gotten that many of them. I think it's because I look like a pumpkin on the damn TV. Maybe a pumpkin woman will email me and tell me about how I move her to laying on the fainting couch because she has dreams of a pumpkin man. But there was a horror movie back in the 80s, a Pumpkinhead. That was scary. I remember that, the video store. I never did finish that. That scared the hell out of me. Self-deprecating, honest sharing about my lack of courage. But one more swig before we get to this great conversation with Dave Silverman. Hold on. Hold on. So good. And we're also going to do some other things. We're going to do this great conversation. Then we're going to come back here at the virtual bar. And I'm going to do my reading, even with my voice, not as dynamic and awesome as it normally is, of our Wall of Honor, which is where I list the locales of all the kind people who donated to our fundraiser. I'm still sending out thank you notes. It's going to take me a week or two. This week was just crazy. I want to thank all the folks who donated to support my work online and elsewhere. I want to thank all the folks who subscribe every month. That means a lot to me too. But I mean, it's so much just positive energy afoot and so much, I'm telling you, some really cool stuff is about to happen and y'all are going to be there. We're going to have each other's back and I'm going to be telling you about that very, very shortly. It's an exciting time. It's a very, very, very exciting time. And those good things would not have come to pass. Like I said last time, we're going to succeed on Fury Road, like Mad Max, gloriously. We're going to go to Falala. We're going to crash and blow up. But you know what? If that happens, we're going to pick ourselves up and keep on strutting. We're going to make it across the wasteland. So next segment again, Dave Silverman, here on the eponymously named podcast, known as the Chauncey DeVega Show.
This land is your land, and this land is my land. From California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters, this land was made for you and me. As I went a-walking that ribbon of highway, and I saw above me that endless skyway, I saw below me that golden valley. This land was made for you and me.
You woke up today, was like, okay, I got the contract, I got the tour, that's all set up, the book has been delivered. Like, how did you feel? What was the thought process like?
So I woke up this morning and, well, the interesting thing is that I went out to the door yesterday and my book was already on the shelf. So I already had been able to go to the bookstore and take my picture with my book. and that was exciting. And
which is a rite of passage.
It is, it is. And really, it's not so much the day that's happened. The big weight that's happened is that the reviews are coming in. And the reviews are good. It's massive that Hemant Mehta rated me the best atheist book of the year. It's massive that Dan Arell gave me 5 stars. This is the stuff that makes me breathe easier. Because, you know, you put your time and your effort into it. You get your contract. And I went through so much to get that contract. I went through, you know, I had the original contract and that contract fell through. Then I found an agent. And she got me the contract with Macmillan, which is one of the largest publishers in the world. And then they cut half the book out so that I had to rewrite half the book. And so this was a lot of work and a lot of time and a tremendous amount of my effort. But really, getting it out, getting the contract, getting it done. But when those reviews come in, when it's not your friends anymore, and I'm not saying that Dan and Hemant aren't my friends, but neither of them is going to protect me. Neither of them ever have protected me from criticism, especially not their own. And when these folks come out and say, yeah, this is good, or even better, this is great, it's a huge weight. It's massive. And I'm sure that for somebody like Sam Harris or Richard Dawkins, you know, putting out a book and getting that kind of validation is old hat. But for me, on my first day with my first book, that was a thing for me to wake up to. I think that was this morning. It has been a long day, but I think it was this morning when I found out that I was rated the number one book of the year by Hemant. And it's a tremendous weight. And now that that's off, now that I've got the book tour all set up, now I'm really looking forward to the book tour. Now, I mean, people are liking this book a lot. Now I'm just going for a ride.
Stumbling back very quickly, you know, what were some of the reviewers' comments like? Because, you know, for folks listening, you do a book, academic press or commercial press, it's sent out to blind reviewers. Sometimes, depending on the topic, you can figure out who it is because the world is so small.
Yeah.
But, I mean, what were some of the comments like? And did they want you to cut half of it out just for readability?
No. They wanted, from Macmillan, they wanted me to cut half of it out. Originally, the book was half about Firebrand Atheism and half about me, and they took everything about me out. You know, people have been asking me more recently for advice on getting published, and I can't say this enough. Find yourself an editor who will tell you to cut everything about you out of the book for the sake of the book, because that is the best advice I've ever had. I followed it and I created a much better book, and now the comments are coming back. And I'm very happy that they're consistent in their comments. What I'm getting back is that this book is different. It's not like the other books that are out there. And of course, I was going for that. But now three different people of note had told me separately that this book is very different from the other books that are out there, because this is not about this is why I'm an atheist and this is why you should be an atheist. This is about why you should not call yourself anything but an atheist. Why you should not be okay with moderate religion, why you should not be okay with privilege, why you need to stand up and shout from the rooftops, why it's a good thing for you to do that, why it is more humanistic to call yourself an atheist than it is to call yourself a humanist. And this is the next level of the, you know, if we take Christopher Hitchens to be true, that religion poisons everything. That's certainly where I started. When I was thinking about this book, I was thinking about God is not great. He doesn't go all the way. He really doesn't. He says, look, this is bad, and this is bad, and this is bad, and religion is a poison, and it hurts people. Well, if religion is a poison and it hurts people, isn't it our ethical duty to help them out of it? If religion is a poison that cons people, aren't we doing good, even if it's against protest, to help people rid themselves of religion? Now, I'm not saying that we should go door-to-door knocking on doors.
Absolutely.
I'm not saying that. But I am saying that if we did, if I got up at 8 o'clock in the morning on a Sunday morning and I walked across the street to my religious neighbors and I knocked on the door and I got invited in and systematically I converted the entire family to atheism, you must admit that good has been done there. And that, you know, we as atheists have this whole, oh, I'm not going to do that. Oh, I'm not going to do that because that's what religion does attitude. Well, that seems to me that benefits only religion. That doesn't benefit us at all. It doesn't benefit the believers either. It benefits the people in charge. It benefits the politicians. It benefits organized religion that atheists are loath to talk about it, to persuade people, because it makes them look like religion. And I think that's wrong. And I'm not saying, like I said, that we should go door to door. I'm saying that we have to own the fact that there is a positive side to convincing people that there is no God. That there is a positive side to, for lack of a better word, preaching atheism. And we have to own that. I think that once we grasp that, once we own that, I think we'll be able to much more easily take our place in society, because people will hear from us. You know, the whole idea is that we atheists, we shy away from it to such an extent that I say in the book, in Fighting God, I say that nearly 90% of the atheists in this country don't call ourselves atheists because we don't even want to be in that position. We don't even want to have that conversation. We call ourselves anything else but atheist. Anything.
And I was thinking, you know, you sort of hinted at it earlier. Do you think that folks who call themselves secular humanists, are they just poo-pooing this? Are they scared? Are they just trying to find a safe way to say that they're atheists? Or they don't have the vocabulary? Is there something else?
Oh, they certainly have the vocabulary. And I don't want to speak for all secular humanists. I know a lot of secular humanists. I mean, I'm a member of the American Humanist Association. I am a proud humanist, but I'm also an atheist. And I never identify as an atheist. So I do say that, yeah, there's a big section of people who go way out of their way to avoid calling themselves atheists because they're afraid of doing so. and they hide behind euphemisms such as agnostic, such as secular mm-hmm. humanist, such as Jew, Muslim, Christian, bright, whatever you want to call yourself. They call themselves a whole bunch of different things. And yeah, many times it is fear. And I go into this in Fighting God, and I call them on that because it's not fear of, oh my goodness, I'm going to get killed. It's fear of something really, really mild. Oh, I don't like atheists. Something like that. That's what they're fearful of. That's what they're trying to avoid in many cases. And I say that that's a very selfish act. I say that that is an act, when you use a term, and I go into this again in the book, that it is misunderstood. The word humanist is mm-hmm. misunderstood by 89% of the population. 89% of the population, when you say humanist, they don't think atheist. Okay? So, on the other hand, when you use the word atheist, 87% of the population does know what it means. So if you're going around and you know that you're an atheist and you're saying things that you know have a 90% chance of being misunderstood, how are you telling the truth? You're not. You're colluding the issue. You're not conveying the honest answer. And why are you doing it?
Do you think some of it could just be fear? Because atheists and then Muslims are the two most disliked groups in America.
Yeah.
And folks are just cowards and they're scared to actually own what their own philosophical and life system is.
I think that's part of the case. That's definitely the case in some people. And I think they have to be called on it because I think we have to own, again, as a group of people, we have to own that what you call yourself affects me. It's not a matter of your personal choice, and I don't have any business in it. I have business here. When 90% of the atheists in this country call themselves something other than an atheist, and as a result, we have a political system that is overrun with religion, because the atheists are calling themselves secular, rationalistic, humanistic agnostics instead of atheists. It affects me. It affects you. It affects my kid. It affects my neighbors. It affects the entire world. And it's doing it en masse. And we atheists have a responsibility. Yes, a responsibility to step up and defeat that crap. And we only do that by using the word, not by hiding behind euphemisms. When somebody calls himself some sort of euphemism and not an atheist, it is my business. It is, because it affects me. And we have to own that. We stopped stem cell research for 8 years during George W. Bush because atheists were 3% of the population, 2% of the population, 1% of the population. Secular nuns, secular humanists, agnostics, there's another 5, another 9, another 3, another 4%. It all adds up. They're all atheists hiding behind euphemisms in many cases, and that hurts us. And it is our business. And it's something that I hope that people start to own. We have a group ethic here. We have an ethical obligation as a group to help each other and to help this country and to help this world, to help humanity. As humanists, it's our obligation to call ourselves atheists and be out and proud and loud about it. Because that's how we defeat the scam of religion. That's how we defeat the lie of God.
Yeah, I want to give you a compliment. I've seen you on Fox News quite a few times, seen you in your debates, and I've had chances to go on Fox News to be on Hannity. I have not been invited on O'Reilly, and I've said no several times simply because the format and the fact that it's a setup. And I was like, I don't want to do the both sides do it and sort of be fed to the wolves, so to speak. Because if I were to go on the show, and I've used this strategy when I've been interviewed by sort of right-wing talk radio folks when I used to do that, is I'm just going to stick to my talking points and ignore you. And I'm going to ignore everything that you say, because I know you're not going to listen anyway. So first, I want to compliment you on how well you've handled O'Reilly and Hannity and others. And what the hell is it like to go on that show? And what strategy did you use?
It's a lot like the strategy you just said. I go into those shows with sound bites preformed. And I go in with sound bites with responses preformed, too. So I have an arsenal of things that I just blurt out one at a time, and I just pick which one I'm going to shoot at any one time. It's a lot of fun, I will tell you that, to go up against Hannity and O'Reilly. It is very, very ego-stroking that I currently believe that, I really do believe that Hannity is afraid of me. He won't have me on he won't have me on one-on-one anymore. He will only have me on 3-on-1, 4-on-1. Gretchen Carlson doesn't have me on anymore. That's too bad. And O'Reilly last year. He knew I was ready. He had, instead of having me on, he had other people on to talk about me. Okay, and I'm here. And
I like when you're sitting there, I mean, with Hannity, because he wanted to have him, Juan Williams, and somebody else versus me. And I was like, I know it's set up when I see it, number one. And like, what is it like when you're sitting there with them? Are they winking at you? Do they actually believe what they say? No. Or do they say, we're doing this for the low-information mouth breathers who are plugged into the right-wing entertainment complex? Or is it just their personalities, like pro wrestlers? I mean, what the hell are they like?
Well, Sean Hannity, I believe, a genuine person. I think the Sean Hannity that you see on the air is a real Sean Hannity. And what's going on is, if you look at that most recent time when I was there, he went to me, and then he cut me off. And then he started to go to the others, the other three people. And I asked him, are you going to let me in? Are you going to let me speak? And this is while they're speaking, okay? And they're not letting me in. And I asked Sean, are you going to let me respond? And he said no during the show. And so I said, okay. And I started speaking up and I started interrupting and I started taking them on in a real loud fashion. Because if you're not going to wait for me, I'm going to bust in. You're not getting those words in edgewise without me. And it's fun, Chauncey. It's fun. I go in there and the nice thing is, and this is the big picture thing. The nice thing, Chauncey, is we're right. And that means that I can go against 4, 5, 6, 12, 20 people and still win. All I have to do is get my facts straight. I could go against the Pope and O'Reilly and Hannity and Benny Hinn and Billy Graham all at once and win because we're right and the facts are with us. And all we have to know is the facts and we have to back our stuff up and then we can win. And that's the beauty of going on Fox News because they stack the deck out of fear. They stack the deck out of knowing that I can handle them one-on-one. I can beat them one-on-one, two-on-one, three-on-one. I can do that because I'm right and they're wrong. And it's a fun thing to do. It's a fun thing to make them flustered. To make them unhappy. I loved it.
It's a corrective. But what was your path? I know you were raised Jewish.
Yeah.
And what was your sort of path of discovery about becoming an atheist and owning that title and owning that identity?
I stopped believing in God when I was 6 years old. It's one of those things that I remember very clearly. I stopped believing in God, the Easter Bunny, the Tooth Fairy, and Santa Claus all at once in the backseat of my mother's car at 6 years old. Told my mother. My mother said, you're still going to Hebrew school. You're the only boy in this Jewish family, and we're keeping up with the Goldbergs, so you're going to Hebrew school. And so I went to Hebrew school, and I asked all the correct questions, and I got all the stupid answers that you could possibly imagine. And it just pushed me farther away from religion. I was bar mitzvahed as an atheist. I was told to do a perfect job, and I did. And I got up in front of my entire universe at my bar mitzvah, and I lied. I lied completely through my teeth. Let us declare the greatness of our God and render honor unto the Torah, which God gave through Moses as a heritage to the congregation of Jacob. I got the whole thing memorized. Of course I do, because I had to. And then I realized that people were lying, that I wasn't the only one lying from the stage. That's when I realized that people from the bima, from the stage, don't necessarily tell the truth. And then came confirmation. Now, Chauncey, I don't know if you know a lot about Judaism or a little about Judaism, but I'll tell you something about Judaism. Judaism doesn't have confirmation. They don't have that. Unless your temple is greedy and wants money. If your temple is greedy and wants money, then you can get confirmed. Confirmation means you go back to school for 2 hours twice a week for 2 years, and then you get to go back up on stage and get a nice certificate, and be called a really, really good Jew. So I had to do that. But the problem was I went away to high school. I lived 200 miles away from home. So, sorry, Mom, can't do confirmation classes. I'm really bummed. But no, my mother made a deal with the temple that if she paid for classes anyways, and I did a final report, which was equivalent to 2 hours twice a week for 2 years, I could graduate with my class. And so, for 2 years, my mother paid for classes that I did not attend. And for 2 years, I did absolutely nothing for this project. And so it came to turn in this project, and I had nothing. I had nothing. Now, Chauncey, I've always been a person who's all about to thine own self be true. I know my strengths and I know my weaknesses. I can speak in front of huge audiences. I can debate anybody about atheism. I have no artistic talent. None. None. So, having said that, I went to the office and I took a piece of copier paper and I drew a circle and I colored in green and blue to make it look like a globe, and I drew a hand holding up the circle. I want you to understand, I have no artistic talent. This looked like a five-year-old did it. It took me 15 minutes, maybe less, and I put it in an envelope. I labeled it God Holding Up the World. I put it in an envelope, and I mailed it in as my final project, and it was accepted without comment. And I went to my graduation, and I saw that I had the same certificate that the other kids had, and that's when I realized what a scam it was. That's when I realized it was all about the money, not about the religion. And then I went to high school, and I ended up going to college at Brandeis. And at Brandeis, I was a hardline atheist by then. I was owning the word. I was using the word. That's what I was. I got the word in seventh grade, but I was a hardcore atheist by the time I was in college, and I started to debate the Jews a lot, and there were a lot of Jews, and there were a lot of debates, and I ended up marrying one of the Jews, and we've been married for 24 years now. So she just actually has come out. Because after 23 years, she started having serious doubts about God. And when she read my book, she decided that she needed to come out as an atheist. And after 23 years, she did, just now, just recently. What happened was I started volunteering for American Atheists when I was 30. Maybe 28. I started volunteering, and all this time I was a professional inventor at Bell Labs, and I was all about my MBA and my career, and I was doing all that stuff to go up the ladder. And as I was doing that, I was volunteering for American Atheists for fun, and then they made me state director, and I said, okay, and then they made me national spokesperson, and I said, okay, and then they made me vice president, and I said, okay. So I wasn't trying to go up the ladder at American Atheists at all. The ladder pulled me up. It was in 2010 when then-President Ed Buckner told me that he was retiring, that he would support my candidacy for president, and that's what happened. I've never looked back. You mentioned before about loving your job. I've got the best job in the world. I love it. I live and breathe this stuff. And the reason I live and breathe this stuff is not just because I'm right. It's because we're good. We're the good guys. We're fighting for equality. We're not fighting for special rights for ourselves. We're not fighting to hurt anybody. We're fighting for equality. And if the Jews and the Muslims get equality, that's good for us. So that makes us the good guys.
Here's an interesting question. I'm sure you've had this come up in your debates, because I said I don't work from notes. It's conversation, just big ideas. And I wasn't prepared to ask this question, but I said the obvious must be, obvious intervention. I'm thinking as an African-American, my folks' history, just had a genealogy done. Half were free, half were slave, thinking about the Middle Passage and the transatlantic slave trade. Our Jewish brothers and sisters, certainly their experience with a different type of slavery, but certainly the Holocaust.
Mm-hmm.
And this is like, I'm thinking when I was in college and, taking all these religious studies classes, philosophy classes, trying to grapple with the problem of theodicy. The problem, as we well know, the all-knowing, all-good God that allows evil.
Right.
How do populations like African-Americans or black folks more generally in the West, Jews in Europe and elsewhere, how have they maintained faith in the face of absurd barbarism and evil that would suggest that God doesn't exist? Because, what sort of God would let all that hell happen to all those people?
The bad news is the answer is really easy, and it's really plain. It's brainwashing. And that's all it is. And that's all we're talking about here when we're talking about religion. It's brainwashing. So many times, take an even more common example. How many times has somebody come up to you and said, gee, I know this doctor, I know this lawyer. He's so smart. He got all his A's in school, but he believes in a God. Why is he so stupid? They're not stupid.
Ben Carson.
they're not stupid. They're injured. They're brainwashed. The black folk who don't think about, slaves obey your masters, they're brainwashed. The Jews who survived the Holocaust and think God has them as the chosen people, they're brainwashed. They're injured. They're hurt. They're not stupid. They're not just wrong. They're injured. They're being hurt by a lie. And this is what This is what we fight. You know, this is the stuff that stick in there. Whole concept of I'm not going to call myself an atheist because religion doesn't want me to call myself an atheist. That's another thing. People don't like to fight religion because religion doesn't want them to fight it. It's bad to do that. That's all because of the brainwashing that we, as an entire society, have received by religion, to put religion on a pedestal, to treat it differently from everything else. That's why we do it, and it holds over our heads this concept of eternal life, which is something every human wants more than probably anything else. But so we cling to that, and we hope for that. Carrot keeps us praying to a God who obviously creates evil, if he exists, who obviously gives babies leukemia. You know, the baby's born with leukemia. The family prays. The baby gets cured from leukemia. The family says, yay, it's a miracle. They never claim, hey, you know, why did God give my kid cancer in the first place? No, they don't do that because they're brainwashed into not doing it. And that's one of the things that we need to fight. We're not fighting stupidity. We're fighting brainwashing, and we need to know that if we're going to understand it. This is why it's so hard to convince people sometimes.
And that's why, you know, I'm fascinated by the mental gymnastics, because the classic solution to the puzzle of theodicy, and it could be someone who has that language or someone who just grows up in the church or the synagogue or the mosque, is that it's not evil, it's an absence of good. And when I heard that in college and started reading more, I said that is the most grotesque, utter BS, and it just doesn't hold up to any sort of critical inquiry. But again, the mental gymnastics that people will go through to maintain this belief system they've been socialized into, it boggles the mind.
It does. Quite literally, it boggles the mind. That's quite a literal statement. It does boggle the mind. It's something that we as a society are facing, that we're not talking about convincing someone that someone is true. Rather, we are convincing somebody that they've been lied to. That's the difference in the approach. If you say my way is right and your way is wrong, well, that's no different from them saying your way is right and their way is wrong. If you say, however, you've been lied to and here's where, well, that's nothing that they can say to you. That's a different conversation, and that'll get the wheels turning. And you have to not put blame on your parents, because your parents were victims too. They only brainwashed you because they were brainwashed into thinking they had to. It's not them being stupid. It's not them being foolish. It's them being victims, just like you. We have to not go into the whole insult concept. We just have to really own the fact that we are talking about a mental assault. Religion is a mental assault. It is inflicted on people, and it hurts, and it's painful, and it's wrong, and it's a lie, and that's why we, as good people and as good atheists, are obliged to help people free from it.
You know, one of the most influential, I mean, it was mind-blowing when I read it, and I actually talked to him a month ago. I'll be putting that conversation out on the podcast probably beginning of the year in January. You're probably familiar with his work. His name is Stephen Reese, and he wrote the 16 Strivings for God. Basically looking at, he identifies 16 basic needs that all human beings have, and how the degree to which those needs are satisfied influences the types of religions that people either sustain, convert into, or choose to live as life systems.
Yes, right. I've heard this.
And I mean, it's a very, very powerful argument, because I was just thinking, of course, you know, the end number, trying to be a good social scientist, is rather low. I haven't done a formal survey on this, but just from anecdotes, all the folk that I know who've either converted to a religion, it could be Christianity, it could be Islam, or the folks I know who are fundamentalists, who I grew up around as an African-American working-class kid, because I renounced religion. I was supposed to be Catholic. I renounced it when I was about 9 or 10. And I remember being in church listening, and I said, okay, these stories are good. They're myths. And I started going to the library. My parents always said, go to the library. And I was like, well, there's not much empirical evidence for this. Maybe there's some history. But it was really the behavior of the people I saw who proclaimed to be the most faithful that disturbed me the most. And then as an adult, encountering folks who were, you know, fundamentalist or converts to either Islam or Christianity, in almost every example, as I said, the end is pretty low, it exacerbated every negative personality trait that they had. And then it just gave them the religious language to defend their propositions. But in terms of sort of thinking about Reese's model about personality types, like with converts, you know, we're thinking about this as atheist/agnostics, whatever language you want to apply to me. When people convert or choose a faith, right, they're leaving what they were born in. They're trying to satisfy a psychological need. How much of it is conscious and subconscious? I mean, who willingly, you know, in your experience, when you go out and talk to folk, when they're converting, what are they looking for? Are they just trying to satisfy something, or do they actually think that God has given him some sort of truth?
Well, that's a loaded question. Another study, and I can't quote it, it's in the book, shows that need positively correlates to the need of religion. In other words, if you're hungry and poor and broke, you're much more likely to go to religion. And that there's a cause and effect there. And as people become less poor, and I don't want to say less poor, as the need for water is, as everybody gets food and everybody gets water, that people are going to get less religious. I think when you're looking at why people convert or convert out of it, I think it's all individual. I wish I could tell you there's one great big way, but I think what it is that everybody has doubts. And I think addressing those doubts and not being afraid to address those doubts is the key, you know, because people don't address their own doubts. They're afraid of those doubts. Those doubts will get them into hell if they really address them. You know, remember, when you die, God is going to read your mind, and he's going to decide whether or not you have enough faith to get into heaven. So those doubts in the back of your mind are the scariest things you have. So you compartmentalize them. You push them away. And cultivating people's okay with those doubts, cultivating those doubts and cultivating the people analyzing those doubts and coming out with them and talking about them is really key to deconverting most people. But I think if you've got a serious brainwashing and you've got serious need, you've got a lot of brick walls. And one of the things that I point out in fighting God is that while this is a good battle and an ethical battle to fight, and I've just talked about how it's an ethical battle to fight, it should not be our primary battle. Our primary battle is not to convert theists into atheists. Our primary battle is to convert closeted atheists into outed atheists, to go to the people who are already atheists, those who use other words, those who go to church, those who say they believe in God but don't, to convert them into atheists is a much easier and much bigger bang for the buck job. I think concentrating on the church pew atheists, the so-called Jewish atheists, which is half the Jewish population, more than half of the Jewish population, and talking to those people who go by any of the euphemisms and getting them to come out as atheists loud and proud, this is a faster and easier way for us to win this war. This is our way to do it. And yes, ethically, we all want to free the Borg from their collective.
Locutus watches and smiles. Jean-Luc Picard.
Exactly. Exactly. You know, we want Hugh to be free of the collective. But when Hugh is a part of the collective, we have to treat him like a part of the collective. And quite frankly, it's just much easier to make allies out of people who already agree with you. They just have the wrong words.
I think you're right. I mean, I love, you know, storytelling and sharing, because I'm obviously very fascinated by how you made, you know, your marriage work for so long with somebody who was of faith, right? They were Jewish and since have come over to share your beliefs, because, you know, always trying to be transparent. And I was involved and cared for somebody, wonderful human being. I have other friends who are wonderful who happen to be religious. But over time, I really came to realize, and I remember there was a few moments, certainly when folks would try to use evidence, quote unquote, from whatever their holy book is to try to justify their own behavior. And I'd be like, well, you know, that's like a Spider-Man comic to me. Maybe it's right or not. It's an interesting story, but it's very hard. And actually, I was talking to a colleague who's a psychologist, and he specializes, he's Christian. And a lot of his practice is trying to work with folks who are, you know, fundamentalists or devout Christians who also need mental therapy and health care. And he and I have talked many times about the whole situation. And he said, Chauncey, you know, the fact of the matter is some personality types and some religious types are just not compatible with each other. So if you have somebody who's a devout Muslim or a devout Jew or fundamentalist Christian and you're an atheist or agnostic, you can love each other to death. But that's going to be a fight about almost every aspect of your life, because there, what you call faith, you know, the belief in that which can't be proven by empirical or demonstrable means, to them, that's the truth. And you're going to be, and he said, you will be in a living hell situation with this person because their truth is different and there's no convincing, and he's religious. He said there's no convincing someone who's that oriented and who's converted over to a religion. I mean, so how did you make it work? I mean, was your wife already sort of thinking in those terms, and it was just sort of love and experience and exposure said, hey, we can make this work?
Well, there's a big variable there. And when you're talking about my wife, you're talking about a Jew, and you're talking about a Reformed Jew when we were married. And the important variable there is that Jews don't have hell. And if they don't have hell, they don't have a concept of saving a soul.
Oh, okay.
So if my wife was a Christian, she would be afraid that I was going to go to hell And she would, because she loved me, want to convince me that I'm wrong so that I can go to heaven. That would be the nice thing for her to do if she was a Christian. But as a Jew, she doesn't have that responsibility. As far as Jews are concerned, when I die, I'm going to see God and he and I are going to have it out. It's not a matter of her responsibility to save me. And that's the big variable. Because in order to live in a mixed marriage, you must accept each other as you are and openly and honestly say, I'm not going to change you. If you never change for the rest of our lives together, I'll be fine with that. If you're with a Christian or a Muslim, chances are they're not going to be able to say that because they love you and they want you to spend eternity in heaven with them. And that's a problem. That is going to be a very difficult problem to conquer. With Jews, specifically Reform Jews, but also the other Jewish sects as well, to a lesser extent, there's no concept of saving a soul. There's no concept of she's bad if she doesn't convert me. The only problems that we had were about raising the kids Jewish. Back then, I thought that Jewish atheism was real. I consented to some compromises on the religion side. I said that I would never pay for my daughter to have classes where she was taught that Dad the Atheist was bad. And I think that was a reasonable thing, and my wife agreed. So my kid was exposed to cultural Judaism, and she came out an atheist. It was fine. Now, if we had, if my wife had gotten more religious over time, or if she converted to Christianity or Islam, and then started to try and save me, we would have been divorced long ago.
I mean, and that's some powerful truth-telling, because when you're in the middle of a thing, you don't necessarily see it. And I said your observations are so helpful, because I didn't realize until later one of the big issues I had, as I said, somebody who a wonderful human being, but just was not meant to be because of this religion thing, was about children. And we didn't even have any kids. And I'm like, hey, let Dad explain his beliefs. You can bring the child to the mosque or synagogue, wherever you want to bring them. And then let the child decide. And I have no problem teaching them, Hebrew or Arabic to read the Quran or the Torah. But let the child decide. And it became, as you said, I didn't put it in those terms, that she had a deep concern somehow about my soul and that she wanted family harmony. And for that harmony, we all had to believe the same thing. And I'm just too independently minded a person. And I was like, no. But when you're in the middle of it, you don't have that clarity to understand it.
And it's hard because when you're talking about raising kids, what are you really talking about? You're talking about brainwashing your children.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're talking about. So the example that comes to mind is the Catholic Church. When two Catholics get married, one of the vows they take to get married in the Catholic Church is to raise their children as Catholics. Even if one of them is not Catholic, in order to be married in the Catholic Church, they must be raised as Catholics. Well, what does that mean? That means brainwashing them into the Catholic Church so that they can make Catholic babies. And give the church some Catholic money. This is a cycle that atheists are very often trapped in because they think it's not going to be too bad because they were raised with religion. So why shouldn't I raise my kids with religion? Well, we have to raise awareness of the fact that that's harming your children.
And there's actually a lot of empirical evidence. I was just reading an article about the ability of children who are raised with religion in the home to actually discern reality from fiction, and that it impacts their ability to learn.
Isn't that scary? And we're doing this to our country en masse. And what you're talking about right now, Chauncey, you're not talking about religious fanatics. You're talking about the moderates. You're talking about the Reform Jews. You're talking about the cafeteria Christians. You're talking about the Christmas Easter Christians. You're talking about the so-called, the moderate Muslims, the mellow Muslims. These are the people who are raising kids who don't know the difference between reality and fiction. Tell me that doesn't affect me. Tell me that that's okay. Tell me that that's ethical to let live and let live.
It's funny you use that example, and certainly we're going to move on to talking about ISIS and the GOP because I'm so fascinated in the Catholic Church, certainly with these sex scandals if we have time. But here's, like I said, another anecdote. I'm sure you probably have read about these experiments. I do this every year with my students in college. So teaching a course on political socialization, I was being not mercurial or troublesome. I'd like to believe I was being a good professor. So we started talking about faith and belief and identity. And I brought up the research, or the experiment rather, where you either take a flag, in this case an American flag, or you write the word God on a piece of paper. And you put it on the ground, and you ask the students if they'd be willing to step on it. Or you ask them to raise their hand. Would you be willing to step on this piece of paper that has G-O-D written on it? Out of a class of 30 people who are reasonably intelligent, who are supposedly going to be critical thinkers, I think only two of them said they would.
Wow.
And I asked, what are you afraid of? It's a piece of paper with marker on it that says G-O-D. And some of them, like, didn't even want to answer, like, they were afraid. Others said, well, it's disrespectful. And I said, to who or into what? To religion. And I said, well, let's think about our priors. What about religion deserves a priori respect? Is it not what people do with religion or their own human ethics and values? And we talked about it for about 20 minutes, one of those moments of critical intervention. And I said, we're in the 21st century, and what you're doing is talking about magical thinking and superstition. Mm-hmm. I said, you're in the 21st century, and you're superstitious about standing on a piece of paper because you think you're going to get struck dead by lightning. And right. When you hear these stories, I mean, it really is pre-modern, pre-enlightenment in thinking, but it possesses millions and millions and millions of people.
Yeah, it possesses the majority of the world, and it's holding back our entire species. That's why it's important for us, it's important for the species to kill religion dead. This is one of the things that we need to understand, and one of the many reasons that religion needs to die, and that we need to kill it. Because if we don't kill it, nobody will, right? So this is why we have to, and this is why there's a moral imperative here. Because it's holding back other people's children, because it's holding back us as a country, and because it's holding back us as a species. I mean, you should just look at ISIS. Mm-hmm. You can see how it's infecting people. Let me divert on something here.
Yeah, by all means.
I was watching the Democratic presidential debate, the most recent one, and they were talking about international affairs. They were talking about ISIS. And the question to Hillary Clinton, to Secretary Clinton, was, okay, get inside their heads, tell me what you see, and tell me how to defeat them by getting inside their heads. And I got to tell you, there are very few times that I'm really disappointed with what the Democrats say, okay? What Hillary said was, well, they're just evil. They're out on a bloodlust. They're here to kill. They're here to maim. I tell you, Chauncey, it could have come right out of Ted Cruz. They're just bad. They're just bad. They're here to kill America. No, they're not. They think they're doing good. Mm-hmm. They think they're doing God's work.
And they're going to create a paradise on earth, which is what these Christian dominionists and Reconstructionists, who I would suggest are fundamentally the same as ISIS, they want the same thing.
Yes, that's why they're not having this conversation. That's why this conversation is not being had, because it looks exactly like Christian dominionism. But these people are doing bad in the name of good. They're doing bad because their God tells them to. They're doing bad just because they think their God wants them to. They don't have a problem killing children because death isn't real. Those kids that they're killing, they're going to go to heaven early. They're doing those kids a favor. When they kill people in the street, they're doing them a favor because they're sending them to heaven early. This is what the problem is, and this is why we're not going to be able to beat ISIS by just saying they're bad, they're bad, they're bad. We have to come clean with the fact that their motives are good, but their methods are bad, and their methods are exactly identical to Christian dominionism. They're exactly identical to the people who shoot abortion clinics.
Thinking, yep.
They're exactly identical to the people who bomb the Olympic parks. They're exactly identical. I'm doing bad in the name of good because my God wants me to. This is the problem with ISIS, and this is why we're not addressing it this way, because if we address it this way, it'll make Christians think twice about their Christianity. This is the scam that affects us all.
When I think about and write about these issues, I had a piece I wrote on ISIS that were basically outlined. You know, I made a list of 10 things, certainly not a novel idea, because radical Islam and radical Christian dominionism and Reconstructionism, they're about 99% the same thing, maybe 100% the same thing. And just to inject that into the public discourse, there are a few brave souls like yourself and others who will say it. Well, that's verboten, and it'll get you kicked out of the public square. And never mind, you know, the idea that these Republicans, it's terrifying. They're talking about God's law should trump the Constitution. And where are the, you know, the reasonable voices? There are not enough of them in the mainstream, you know, corporate news media, certainly, saying, well, number one, this is not a theocracy. But we have plurality, if not a majority, of Christian American voters who believe the country should be a theocracy. And that just says so much about the state of our civic affairs.
Yes, and it's about our education system, because they don't understand how bad that is. They don't understand that in a theocracy, they would suffer too. They don't get that. And that's really got a lot of blame has to be put on our education system there. Of course, the lies that preachers tell and the politicians in their pockets. And yes, the fact that atheists are so goddamn closeted that we aren't even seen as a resource for people who have doubts. This is why we have to come forward. This is why it is our ethical responsibility to come forward as atheists, not as euphemisms, but as actual atheists who are aware of the issues and are not afraid to speak about them.
If you had sort of Obama's ear or Hillary Clinton or whoever, you know, the United Nations or NATO Supreme Allied Commander, Europe, whoever's in charge, and they're asking me for advice about how to deal with ISIS, in terms of sort of owning the talking points and not necessarily thinking about geopolitics or IR theory, is it a problem of religion in general, and these are just variants of Abrahamic faiths that are bloodthirsty and violent? Is it really just about political economy and people use religion to get what they want? Because I was reading, I think Der Spiegel had a great piece about one of the founders of ISIS, and he was like this intelligence officer in the Iraqi military who was basically like an atheist, and he figured he could use this religion stuff to basically advance his own campaign of revenge against the Shiites. So in terms of geopolitics, is it religion in general is a type of human livestock management system that's run amok, or is there something particular about Islam in this historical moment that's creating ISIS, or is both, neither, something else?
Islam is not just Islam, okay? Mm-hmm. Islam, you know, everybody talks about Islam as only one sect, but we all know that Islam has many sects and many, many sections, and it is, there is a problem with that specific brand of Islam because it has infected huge amounts of people into thinking that it knows what objective good is. And it talks about the objective good, it brainwashes people into the objective good. You know, I talk about moderate religionists in fighting God, breeding grounds for extremists, because the big lie, the biggest lie is the lie of God. There is a God out there who cares. And second biggest lie is there are people on earth who knows what the God wants. Okay? And those lies are taught to every religionist child on the planet. There's a God and people on the earth know what he wants. And then saying the third lie is here's what he wants. Well, changing that is easy, right? Because you've got the first two as a base. So, oh, you have a God that thinks he wants peace with the West. Well, I can show you where in the Quran that God doesn't want that, and we can show you that. And that's an easy push, okay? And so how do you fix it? Well, it's going to be distasteful, but we have to fix it the way we should fix it, by deconverting the people we capture. We have to take them out of that headspace. We have to teach them that their religion is flawed. Yes, we have to teach them that their religion is flawed. And it'll be politically bad, but once they realize that their religion is flawed, they have no allegiance to it anymore. They're not fearing a God anymore. They can tell us all the information. All we have to do is convince them that there isn't a God, or at least that their God doesn't want them to do that. That's what we need to be doing. And as far as fighting ISIS on the battlefield, well, ISIS is trying to bring us into a war so that we can have some epic battle on some place in the caliphate. I don't forget the city name, but it's inside their caliphate. Mm-hmm. It's inside the ISIS.
Just like
caliphate.
George Bush believed in Gog and Magog and the rapture.
Exactly.
That influenced him to invade Iraq.
Exactly. Well, you know what we should do? We should invade the Islamic State at that city. Give them their battle. Oh, wait, then we win.
I mean, it's a hell of a puzzle because, never mind.
I mean, it's not crazy, right? This is not crazy. If they're trying, if they're walking through the streets of Paris gunning people down, okay? This is not bloodlust. This is not hate. This is a press play. They're trying to goad us into war.
That's right, absolutely.
Why? They want their big epic battle inside their caliphate. Well, what if we dropped a whole bunch of troops inside their caliphate at that city, set up a camp, and waited for them to converge on us? And then blew the crap out of them. That's done. Okay? And maybe it's not going to solve everything, but this is one way to address it. We have to get in their heads. We have to play this game.
And I'm smiling and trying to suppress sort of gallows humor. But then, of course, as all, you know, folks who believe in religious and end times eschatology or eschatological thinking will rebut, well, you have the epic battle, which will actually create more of their converts because they'll say, look, the infidels. And the other part of it would be just like when you have these loons who say the end of the world is next Friday and they sell all their stuff and drink the Kool-Aid. Well, when the end of the world doesn't come, they'll say they misinterpreted the scripture and the battle's supposed to happen somewhere else. I mean, as I said, it literally boggles the mind because of all the outs that faith allows people to sort of manipulate their cognitive processes and reality.
True, but in the meantime, when we start amassing at the city, that city, the name escapes me, they'll bring in everyone they've got to win this battle. They'll bring in everyone from all over the place to win this battle. And then all we have to do is win the battle. And I think we can do that. And then if we win the battle, we can make sure that they know that their big battle inside their caliphate didn't happen. And then from there, we can tell them, we can educate the prisoners, we can make them understand that they've been lied to. Not that they're stupid, but that they've been lied to. And they've been brainwashed into thinking something bad is something good. We can do that. We can win the war. I mean, I'm no war strategist here, okay? I'm just an atheist activist. And this is nowhere near my expertise. And I'm not saying that it is. What I'm saying is that if we're going to win the fight against religious extremists, we can't pretend that their religion is somehow worse than other religions. We cannot shelter criticism of that religion because it'll affect the other religions. We have to get into their head. We have to realize that they think they're doing good. They are, quite frankly, they're people who sleep well at night. They sleep well at night. They sleep happy at night after they kill people because they sent those people to heaven early and they're doing God's work. That is the lie that we have to unconvince people. And that is one of the many reasons that people who are moderate religionists need to drop that stuff, because they're just priming their kids, giving them that first lie and that second lie. God exists and there are people on the planet that know what he wants. Giving them that first lie and that second lie, which primes them for recruitment into extremism of one kind or another. Absolutely. Later on in life. Oh, and by the way, it's not true.
I mean, I'm thinking, you know, we sort of teased it earlier, certainly as we wind down, because I know you're super busy, talk about your where to get the book and where folks can come out and meet you. So I can't tease it and not follow through. So we're going to try to see if you can get me to own my atheism. So I'm sure other folks listening to the show, the podcast, probably have similar beliefs. So I believe that perhaps science is the mind of some entity, right? So the idea, you know, a lot of theoretical physicists sort of claim some sort of belief in God because of the elegance of the universe. I'm unsure if the unified field theory suggests that, but there's some sort of order. I don't necessarily believe that there's some supernatural sky father or mother who watches me in the bathroom or when I have sex. I think it's sort of mythological mumbo jumbo that helps people.
The word is consciousness.
Consciousness. There you go.
Okay. So do you think, and this is the question that I ask people, and ask it very, very literally and very, very carefully. Do you think there is a supernatural consciousness that is not that does not bound by the laws of physics and mathematics of the universe?
No, absolutely not.
Then you're an atheist.
Oh, that was easy. I mean, there's science we don't understand, but some sky father doing that. Oh, absolutely not.
And it's all.
I guess I got to own it now.
you got to own it. It's not about energy, because energy is one of those words that nobody knows what it means. It's not about any of those euphemisms that people use to make it flow. There's this, there's that. Do you think there is a consciousness, a thinking supernatural entity that is not bound by the laws of physics and mathematics that govern this universe? Do you think there is one? If you don't say yes, and frankly, if you delay and you're like, well, I don't know, you're an atheist. Because you don't have a belief in God. And that's what makes you an atheist. And if you don't have an active belief in God, and you absolutely positively hate the word atheist with a passion, you're still an atheist. Deal with it.
That's t-shirt and bumper sticker worthy. But David, where can folks get the book online, and where are you going to be, and where can they come out and see you?
I am so excited to be going on my first ever book tour, and I start off in Los Angeles. I'm doing Riverside, then I'm doing Phoenix, Seattle, Portland, and Las Vegas this month. That's December. My schedule is online at atheists.org/fightinggod. That's atheists.org/fightinggod. My handle on Twitter is Mr. Atheist Pants. Everything goes on there as well. I'm pretty active on Twitter. And the book is called Fighting God, an Atheist Manifesto for a Religious World. It is the first book by a career atheist to be published by a major publisher in American history, which is kind of exciting. Well, okay, it's really exciting. And you can buy it. You can buy it in just about any Barnes & Noble nationwide, most other major bookstores nationwide, Amazon, of course, and you can buy signed copies for a very limited time at American Atheists at atheists.org. The nice thing, again, is big relief, is that it's getting good reviews, and people are really liking it. It's something that I'm really excited about. The book is chock full of data. I do not, this is not just a book about pros, I think this and I think that. This book backs itself up. I have multiple quantitative data sources, independent quantitative data sources, and I use them very well. I think people will find it a pretty enjoyable read and a very interesting read, and most importantly, a very different read. And I hope everyone enjoys it. And Chauncey, I want to thank you very much for having me on your podcast. I really do appreciate all the time you spent with me.
Well, absolutely. It was a pleasure to sit down and chat. And I'm going to take your advice about Fox News if they ask me again and keep that strategy of sticking to my guns and just plowing through and putting on a show. But I want to thank you for sitting down on the podcast. I really appreciated it.
Hey, Chauncey, thanks a lot for having me on, and we'll see you next time.
Cool, cool, cool sharing there from Mr. Silverman. I want to thank him one more time for sitting down here at the virtual bar and salon and talking about religion, faith. And I was dead serious. That question about theodicy is something that has always vexed me. You know, black folk always in the church, crying on their knees, praise dancing. You see that one, that praise dancing video? I think I talked about it last week. We had a person praise dancing in a Pedway scooter. You see that absurdity? Nonsense. And speaking of nonsense, I had to put that Pastor Manning video up for there for New Year's. If you do not know who Pastor Manning is, track down Pastor Manning. Have yourself a drink, a lie, or smoke whatever mind-altering substance that you enjoy. And just try not to fall off of your seat. Because if I had a church like Pastor Manning, and I had that video up on the website talking about there's semen, gay men's semen, as opposed to straight men's semen would be different, I guess, and Starbucks coffee. Man, if I could find a church with that level of entertainment value, I would be there every day. Every day. I throw some money in the collection plate, too. Because if you're putting on a high-quality show like that with that level of entertainment, shoot, I record and put on the internet myself. But I want to thank David Silverman one more time because he is super busy. You see him on, he's been on Fox. They hate his guts, but he puts on a hell of a show. He's been all over the TV promoting his book. He's traveling around the country. And if you get a chance, check him out. Agree or disagree with him. He's a really, really smart guy. Send him emails. Come out and see him and challenge him. I'm sure he will have a pithy and witty answer. And his book is excellent. Agree or disagree, as I said, the book is good. He's compelling, and he's just, like I said, sometimes, I was thinking about this the other day, I'd love doing the podcast, you know that, even when I got the cooties. My voice is hoarse. I love, you know, the privilege of being able to write online. Yeah, it's a lot of pressure. I love the pressure of getting called randomly, having to be ready in an hour or two to run my mouth and bloviate, because I bloviate sometimes too, but I do it with intensity, with character, with excitement, and share my thoughts on the issues of the day, and just try to tell the truth. So there's a lot of pressure, and the pressure is going to increase, but it's a hell of a privilege. And as I said, when I started this podcast, I never would have thought that I'd have the opportunity to talk to the amazing people like Dave Silverman, like all the other folks I've talked to thus far. Tim Wise, by the way, is going to be coming back on the podcast. He and I are just trying to set up a time to talk about all these events. That's one of our most popular podcasts. Richard Slotkin as well. I need to get brother. I keep saying brother Paul Brynes. He's got to come back on. I've been emailing him. Get him to sit back down. Adelifu Nama, we're going to do a round two without Adelifu. And of course, me and champion Joe Lansdale, if you didn't get a chance to check that out, the Happen Leonard TV series, that commercial is online. That show looks great. As I said, I never would have thought I'd have opportunities to talk to these awesome people. Sometimes life, it just happens. You get lemons, you make lemonade, like this great half lemonade iced tea I'm drinking. You add a little sugar and you just drink it down. Whew. This is some good stuff, people. Let me have one more swig before I do the wall of honor, tell a little story, and preview the next episode. Hold on. I just need another little swig. Hold on. And you hear it. That's the clang of my army mug. I'm going to get a second swig. Hold on. Wow. I don't know if we've ever had a six swigger on the podcast. That may have just been history in the making for our humble, eponymous, online virtual bar and salon. But I had an interesting, like I said, New Year's and Christmas. I did what I said. I ordered some that cologne with the kind funds you folks sent me and took myself out for a nice dinner. Told you would do that. Had the good calamari, some filet mignon, three Moscow mules. And got a cab ride home. I'm a champion. But I was really content this Christmas, this New Year, because of all the stuff that's, as I said, years in making, and you struggle and you hustle. And I got a lot of stuff I need to do in other areas of my life, that's for sure. But this other stuff is such a surprise. And I'm waiting to have a panic attack. But as I said, you know, it's like professional wrestling. Going back to that example, give me the belt. let me see what I can do if I'm the champion. I ain't the world heavyweight champion, but maybe the IC champion. And then I'll become U.S. champion, and then I'll get the big belt one day. And you saw that wood, you swing that axe, and you try to make things happen, and you just put that work in. But again, I want to thank all of you. So my point is, I was relaxing. I've been cold out, meditating, trying to charge up my energy for the new year. And I went out, and one of my friends, I got to call my brother who made this observation about some of the things that happened to me in life. He said, Chauncey, you have these strange stories because you're in the habit of going out late at night when no one is around but weirdos. And it's true. Maybe I'm a vampire. Maybe I am Blackula. People say I look like a turtle. Others said Blackula. Whatever. Blackula was a handsome man. So thinking about life contentment and just where you are at a certain point, I was out at one of my favorite mid-tier dining establishments. And it was about midnight. I was reading my graphic novel, American Vampire. If you don't read American Vampire, you should check it out. Having a beer, this is my habit, listening to a podcast on the way back and forth, The Nerdist, catching up on those episodes, some good guests on The Nerdist as of late. If you don't listen to The Nerdist, check it out. You are missing something good. This guy comes into this mid-tier dining establishment, tall Latino, white Latino brother, 25, maybe 26, and he looked a little weird. Like he was just putting his clothes back on, he sits next to me, he talked to some friends, I guess he knew him, and he decides to sit three seats away from me. See, I'm just telling a story because it's going somewhere, people. Trust me. So he makes eye contact. I make eye contact. I just want to be left alone. So he says to me, oh, can I buy you a shot? You see, I'm very observant. See, I don't sit with my back to the door because I don't want to get ambushed. And I size people up in case I need to use my kung fu to defend myself. So I'm checking him over and I notice he had some wristbands on, like in a hospital. I was like, is this man from the psych ward? And he's sitting there and he's dressed up, mind you. And I was like, this guy went out for New Year's. These are New Year's clothes. His shirt is unbuttoned. He's got a jacket on. His slacks look a little wrinkled. He takes his shoes off and starts putting socks on at the bar. And I'm looking at this dude. I'm like, don't judge, Chauncey. Anything can happen in life. So I thought he was going to make the big reveal that he got out the lunatic place, the psych ward. So he proceeds to ask me if I want a shot. And I was like, no, I don't really drink shots, which is true. Now, he can buy me a beer if he wants, but I don't drink shots. So he gets a shot, he gets some food, and he proceeds to start talking to me. And I'm not making fun of the man's affect. And it's always funny, too. A lot of our white brothers and sisters, they think black people have an accent. You think about that? You know, there's a lot of brothers out there. Yeah, you know what I'm saying. You know what I'm saying. Wamp, wamp, you know, I used to say that a few years ago. But you got these white folk, they have an accent too, but to them that's just normal standard English, you see. When they say like every third word, for example. So dude proceeds to tell me in his sort of upper class wannabe affected, but really from Jersey-esque accent, because I'm from that part of the country, I can pick out the sort of turns of phrase. And he starts talking to me, he's like, man, I'm ballin'. I'm crushing it. You know what I do for a living? And he's not malicious. He just assumes I care. And I was like, oh, you know, I like to observe people. So for me, this is all research. This will end up as a character in my graphic novel or my zombie novella, which is still in progress, in case anybody was wondering. And he's telling me his business. I work for the head of UPS, and I do data analysis, man. I'm a monster with spreadsheets. And I guess this is supposed to impress me. And I know there are people who are great math people, and they get off on finding patterns. And I just nodded and smiled. I said, you know, that's cool. I'm glad for your success, man. I'm glad for your success. And at no point does he ask me about myself. At no point does he ask me about who I am. And it's very interesting. I was telling my mother, I said, to exercise a narcissism here. That number one, he assumes that I'd be interested. And number two, he assumes that I'm in a lower social station in life than he is. Because I guess so. Maybe I look like a bum. Maybe I'm just a working class man who reads comic books. Maybe he could just sense my working class roots. I don't know. So he proceeds to, you know, using all this affected speech, man, I'm awesome, I'm smashing, I'm crushing, I'm destroying. And I said, oh, that's wonderful. I said, are you happy? And he's like, what? And I said, are you happy? Yeah, man. I make so much money. I make 92 grand a year, man. I'm destroying it. I'm a supervisor. I tell people what to do and they listen. And I'm not making, that's exactly how we sounded, by the way. And I said, yeah, that's interesting. And a light bulb went off for me in that moment. And I said, maybe I'm just older now. maybe if I was 22, somebody making 90 grand would mean something to me. But even then, I don't really think I cared about those things, which is why I will probably be someone who makes a middling income for the rest of his life. But hey, as long as I'm happy. And I'm sitting here listening to this guy with his assumptions about me, about people around him, as he's now buttoning up his shirt. And I'm like, what happened in your life, dude, where you would measure life happiness and fulfillment by, you know, an upper middle class salary? I don't care if you make $1 billion. What do you do? Are you happy? Are you content? And I was smiling because I almost wanted to pick a fight with dude, but he looked like he could be a little crazy. I was like, I've been offered far more money than that. I could have been a corporate sellout. The real money on the table in another life. And I just, no interest. So maybe I'm just surrendering to the realities of my perpetual working class existence. Or maybe it's life wisdom, where you know a lot of people who make a lot of money, and a lot of them are miserable. I also know people make a lot of money who are happy. But all things being equal, I would take happiness and fulfillment. So then dude let slip that he has been in the hospital, because he asked me, what day is it? I was like, it's Monday. And I said, well, have you been in the hospital? What happened to you, brother? And he won't give the details, but it strikes me as a rich upper class brother. He was, of course, talking about how his brother is awesome and hangs out with Mark Rubio, as though that would impress me either. Assuming it's true. And I guess dude had gotten high, gotten drunk, went to the hospital, came out to Fridays, wanted to brag about crushing it with 90 grand. And tell a working class black man something like that as though he would care. So that's my way of saying I think good things are happening and I have a weird wave of contentment. I'm sure something will come to disrupt it. That is life. But I felt that way since the middle of December when all these good things were announced and I was told about them and they were confirmed. So on that note, because I'm taking positive energy that I was given by all of you in the forms of your well wishes and your material support and donations, I'm going to give thanks for that by reading from my pieces of paper here now, because hopefully I got that right. As I went through the spreadsheet, wrote it down by hand. And of course, I don't give people's names. I don't violate anybody's privacy. But I do like to read, as is our tradition from last year, the cities, towns, and areas, and countries in some cases, of the folks who were just so generous and kind. And it means a lot. I don't care if it's $5 or $250, which was our largest donation. Man, those acts mean a lot, that somebody would do that in these economically perilous times. That people would say, there's this dude named Chauncey DeVega. I like and support his work. I'm admiring what he's trying to do, and I want to throw some change into that collection pile. That's love, and I appreciate it, and I try to pay it forward whenever I can. So, in no particular order, and hopefully I got these right, so I may read a city more than once, and it could be the same person twice, or it could be multiple people. So, in no particular order. So here are the geographic locales of the people, the kind friends and supporters of ChaunceyDeVega.com, the podcast known as The Chauncey DeVega Show, and my various other online work and teaching. So in no particular order, New York, New York, Boston, Massachusetts, Campy, Louisiana, good Creole people, Dade City, Florida, Sunnyside, Queens, our largest donor, and a fan of the show and the website, one of our longtime supporters out of Sunnyside, Portland, Oregon, Highland Ranch, Colorado, Gainesville, Florida twice, Alexandria, Virginia, Columbus, Ohio, Spokane, Washington twice, St. Louis, Missouri, I'm turning the sheet now, La Mesa, California, Long Beach, California, Spokane, Washington again, Gainesville, Florida again, San Francisco, California, Converse, Texas, Brooklyn, New York, another one of our longtime supporters, another friend from Brooklyn, New York, Virginia Beach, Virginia, Middleborough, Massachusetts, good friend up there, Astoria, New York, Hopkinson, Massachusetts, we'll get this right, Yevington, Nevada, Victoria, British Columbia, we got the Canadian hookup here. You also have some, I don't want to mispronounce it, so don't hate on me. Nanaimo, British Columbia, another Canadian hookup there. Thank you for your generosity. LA, California, Freeport, Grand Bahamas, another one of our international friends who's been with us for some time. God, I got to get to the Caribbean. I got to get there. I got to hang out on the beach to show everybody my abs of steel. Bristol, Connecticut, my home state. I went on many a trips. They have these farms up in Bristol that every school kid was dragged to. And I still like those farms up there. And they have petting zoos, all sorts of stuff in Bristol, Connecticut. And a cool mall, too. And some really good bowling. Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. We got some good people. We also have a friend in Finland. We also have donors overseas and other countries, too, who've given over the years. So I want to thank all of these good people. I hope I didn't miss anybody. I'm looking over the list again. I think we're okay. Oh, in San Francisco, California, one of my favorite cities. I knew I had missed something. But I think again, surveying twice now, because I don't want to leave anybody out. Portland, of course. I think we're good. I think we're good. So I want to thank everybody who was so kind to donate. As I said, I'm in the process of sending out those thank you notes. It means a lot to me. And I also want to thank, because a lot of you folks have also done this too. It's amazing. We actually have 5 reviews on iTunes. It should be better than 0. But folks are doing that, writing comments and reviews. And it's weird because you go to the iTunes charts, there's so many ways to view it. Sometimes we're like top 50, then top 200, then 100, then disappear. So it all varies. I got these complicated heuristics, I guess. But I know people are listening to, downloading, sharing, and tweeting the podcast. But if you can, you know my routine at the end of every episode. Please, I know it's work. I know you're listening in the car. I know you're listening on your phones. But if you can, when you get a chance, when you get home, go to that iTunes deal and click on the stars. Give a review, too, because that's going to help us get more eyes on the project. So next week's show, I was talking about Hateful Eight. I've had Brother Adelifo and others talking about Tarantino's work, in particular Django. Hateful Eight is one of the best movies I've seen in recent years. A wonderful companion to Django. So, whenever I get a chance to talk about Tarantino's work, we do it. Next week, we got Oliver C. Speck. He's Associate Professor of Film Studies at Virginia Commonwealth University. He's smart. Expert on film. He has a great book, and they actually had a conference on it, on Django! So we talk about Django. We talk about Tarantino. We talk about film. We talk about he's a German brother living in the South. We talk about historical memory around the Confederacy, slavery, and Nazism in Germany. Then we do we talk about so much stuff. If you're into film, if you're interested in cultural studies, comparative cultural studies, if you're just interested in hearing two folks who love film go back and forth about cinema, about popular culture, I had to call the brother up again because we had talked a few months ago and now you got all this stuff going on with the Paris terror attacks and we have a nice little discussion about mediated reality, digital culture, terrorism. Because we started off by talking about how ISIS makes those horrible videos where they're killing people. These are both tools of terror and recruitment. And after what went down in Paris, thinking about that sort of spectacular and grotesque performance, both of the acts of violence and the way it was covered, and I have a piece of Salon, I came up a little late, where I write about sort of the idea of the spectacular and the grotesque in terms of mediated realities and the news media in regards to what went down in San Bernardino, California. So Dr. Speck and I, we go back and forth, cover all those great topics. I think you're going to really, really enjoy it. I know you're going to learn something. And as I said, check out his book on Django, Collected Essays with some great scholars. And some of the proceedings are online. I think they're actually going to put up the video of some of the conference proceedings as well. So that's next week, second podcast of the year 2016, here on the eponymously named podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. So even when my voice is 85%, we still get the job done. And I'm not going to go for a record-setting 7th swig of the lemonade. Oh, my hand's shaking up. Boy, let me calm down. Lemonade iced tea mix. But I am going to mix it with ginger ale and report on the results next week. So if you hear in the paper about a black man in Chicago who OD'd on soda and had melanin human combustion, you know it was Chauncey DeVega. Let the world know my story, people. Let them know. You gotta laugh. But I want to thank Dave Silverman one more time for taking time out of his day to talk. I want to thank all of you folks. Listen to, download, share, and tweet the Chauncey DeVega Show. I want to thank all the folks who donated to our December fundraiser. We do this twice a year, And of course, you can donate throughout the year. Just go to that PayPal link on the right-hand side of the screen, chaunceydevega.com. Hit that little button. It should work. Now, sometimes those links and the dang posts where it says fundraiser or donate, they expire for some reason. So you can always go on the main page, the right-hand sidebar, click that PayPal, boom, it'll open up for you. So I do take silver, gold, platinum, and other precious minerals. And I also take good and positive energy because that's what this is all about. So this is my standard closer. Please, please, please practice mental, emotional, physical self-care in these trying times. Take care of yourself. Take care of your winged, reptilian, fish, bird, and other insect friends, too. It's cold out. Take care of our birdie and squirrel friends and our pigeon friends. They need help, too. Please reach out via email, phone, text, whatever, to someone you haven't talked to. do that. You had a falling out. You had a breakup. You had a heartbreak. You had a fight over something petty and it escalated. Life is too short a family member you haven't talked to, because at least you will know you did the right thing. And please try to do something nice for a stranger. And please, in these trying times, try to look out for our homeless brothers and sisters. They're not disposable people. That could be you. It could be me. Let's try to help each other out in these dangerous times. Somebody needs a sandwich, get them a sandwich. You got 50 cents? Get somebody 50 cents. Don't judge. Don't judge. It could be you. It could be anybody. So until next week, with Dr. Oliver C. Speck, talking Django, film, mediated realities, digital culture, I want you all to please be well, be safe, take care of yourselves, be righteous, as we used to say, back in the struggle. You think I'm going to have a moment where I don't do my Cornel West voice? Come on. They can have me laryngitis. I'm still going to do Cornel at the end of the show, or the beginning, or the middle. But I want to thank you all. I'm smiling. Thank you all again for supporting my work, and especially the kind donors. That means a lot to me. So until next week, be safe, be well, and take care of yourself.